Well, good morning. We're really glad that you're with us this morning, or this afternoon, or this evening, whichever it is that is easy for you to come and join us, but we're glad you're here. We've got a few announcements this morning, but first of all, we want to just let you know that I think virtual church is really working out. We've got a lot of great comments coming our way. We also have a lot of great suggestions, so keep us on our toes and keep us informed so that we can bring you the best quality service. For those of you that join us during Thursday's Bible study, there's a treat. You can now go to virtual Bible study, and that is whenever you want to. You can find us on our website at www.benevachristian.com and click on the area where it says media and go to Bible study. David is still working on Mark, and the book of Mark is full of interesting journeys and all kinds of stories and suggestions, so we really ask that you check that out and see if you can join us for those virtual Bible studies. Also, we'd like to let you know that Phone a Friend is going very, very well. We're thankful for the ladies that brought that to everybody's attention. We've got some great comments, and I'd like to tell one story where one of our church members does not have access to a computer. So one of our friends had called her up and actually put the phone to the service and allowed her to listen to last Sunday's service. She was so excited, and I thought, what a great idea, and how creative we're getting with this Phone a Friend. So thank you, for ladies, for all the wonderful work that you've been doing. We also want to thank you for your tithes and offerings. We're very much appreciated that they're coming in by way of U.S. mail. And we also have had a few people call in to see what other options that they have to give for their tithes and offerings. So we appreciate that. Also, since our prayer warriors are not meeting on Mondays, that doesn't mean that we should stop praying. Remember, the Bible says, pray without ceasing and everything, give thanks to the Lord. So continue your prayers for all of our Beneva friends and family members and those that are in need of your wonderful prayers and virtual hugs. So we thank you for that. Enjoy the service, enjoy your day, and enjoy your week.
To God in prayer. as we get started today. I want to start with a word of prayer. Let's join together and pray. And Heavenly Father, as we open up your word, as we open up your word in this place, through the gift of technology, we have the opportunity to open up your word throughout the world. And so, Lord, wherever this is being heard and watched at this moment, I pray that your spirit would be present. That your spirit would be present so there would be open hearts and open minds, open ears. That your word would penetrate. That there would be blessing and encouragement. That there would be the hand of grace. That there would be the hand of love. That there would be a seed planted that would grow into a perfect being, that would grow into someone who lives and breathes to serve and to follow. And pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, this week we are starting a new series. And a couple months back when I was meeting with the worship committee and we talked about this series, I told them that the series was going to be called I See You. And some of the people in the worship committee wrote it down, I See You, as an intensive care unit, which I thought was interesting because that wasn't my intention. It was really I-C-S-E-E-U-Y-O-U. But it was an interesting juxtaposition and contemplated it for a moment or two, but I kind of stayed with the notion that the series would be called I See You. And it was basically came out of a time when I was watching this movie Avatar. Some of you might have seen it before. And in the movie, when these two characters are greeting, one is, of course, from another planet, and they greet each other by saying, I see you. And I thought that was interesting because it was this notion of recognition, this notion of understanding, deeper than just being present with someone. And I started to think about our relationship with God, and as we move in towards Easter, I started to think about, you know, that would be a good title for a series around Easter of this notion of seeing, God and being seen by God, seeing others and having others see you, this concept of seeing. So we're going to be spending the next several weeks looking at this concept of I see you. And some people the last couple of weeks have commented about the entry ticket. Well, it's because we really haven't been a part of a series yet. So this week, expect that there will be an entry ticket that will be looked at next time we get together. So pay attention this week so you can definitely get the entry ticket correct next week. And we're going to be taking a look at the story of Job this morning. And we're going to be looking at Job chapter 42, verse 5. This is at the end of Job. Some of you have read the book of Job. Some of you haven't. I would encourage you to do so. It's in the Old Testament. If you get to Psalms, just make a left. You'll find Job there. It is spelled like Job, J-O-B. And it's an interesting story because it's somewhat disturbing at the beginning, because at the beginning there's this picture that's painted of God in heaven with the angels, and one of the angels is Satan, and Satan means deceiver. And they're talking, and God asked Satan, what have you been doing? He said, I've just been scouring the earth looking for people that I can deceive. And he said, well, what about my servant Job? And Satan says, well, Job would never curse you because he's got everything. He's been so blessed by you that he's rich and he's got a good family. Everything's great. And so God gives Satan permission to basically take it all. He just can't harm Job. And that's the beginning of this message or this story of the book of Job. And it's disturbing because you have to sit there and think about this concept of the fact that God is all-knowing and all-controlling. And we don't say things like God caused the coronavirus. But one of the things that we have to understand as we look at life, whether it's the coronavirus or cancer or financial ruin, whatever the case may be, God might not cause it, but he allows it. He allows it to happen. And those are one of those things that on this side of eternity we struggle with and we wrestle with. And it's important for us to struggle and wrestle with it. It's important for us to ask those questions like, God, why would you allow this to happen? Why would you do this to the world? Why would you allow this to go on? And as we take a look at this process of seeing each other, seeing God, I'm hoping that you can get a better handle on that, because it's important. If you're going to take this following Jesus thing seriously, then it's important for you to wrestle with this term and this understanding that God allows things to go on, that he doesn't just stop everything in its tracks, even though we on this side of eternity say you probably should do that, and if you were loving, you'd really do that, or if you were all-knowing or all-powerful, you would do that. And so this process that we're going to go through over the next couple of weeks through Easter time, this concept of seeing is my hope is that on the other side, you'll have a better understanding of the nature of God. You'll have a better understanding of yourself. You'll have a better understanding of others so that you can be more confident in those times when things don't make sense. Confident in those times when you think that maybe God should be doing something that God's not doing. And that is important for us because each and every single one of us must wrestle with this. And so when I was in seminary, I took a course on Job because this book bothered me so much. I struggled with it. And going through this course for a whole semester with a scholar that basically had given his life to studying this book, there was no answer. There was no answer. There was no answer, no satisfaction. I wasn't finding the satisfaction until we got down near the end. And we were studying chapter 42, which is the last chapter in Job. And I came across this one verse in chapter 42, verse 5. And when I came across this one verse, it was like a light bulb went off in my head. And from that point on, I was able to find peace in this notion of why doesn't God act, or this notion of saying, why isn't God doing what I think God should be doing? And this one verse sounds like this. It's Job 42, verse 5. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Let's hear that again. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Thanks be to God for the reading of this word. Those are the words of Job. Those are the words of Job after the destruction, after his family is killed, after he loses all of his wealth, after his wife leaves him, after his three friends, supposedly friends, gather around him and just remind him over and over again that he must have done something wrong because the only reason this would happen is that his sin was so powerful in his life that God had to punish him. And Job, of course, held on to the fact that he didn't do anything wrong. He was a good man, and he was. And so as we take a look at this concept of why do things happen in this life, why do things happen that maybe we believe that God should stop, we get to this deeper understanding of this concept of seeing. And we hear Job's words at the very end after all of this has gone on. Job comes to this realization that my ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. So we're going to take some time today and we're going to pull this apart a little bit and take a look at it. The first thing we're going to take a look at is this notion and this concept that is very prevalent in our culture and in our society. And that is that seeing is believing. Seeing is believing. And that's something that we talk about all the time. That's something that many of us live our whole life by. That if I see it, then I believe it. Thus, the other side of that, the juxtaposition of that is, if I don't see it, I don't believe it. So this seeing is believing is the very first thing that we've got to wrestle with. There's probably not a human being out there that doesn't live some way, shape, or fashion by this notion that seeing is believing. And that's going to be one of the things that are going to be challenged in your life if you take this study seriously. One thing that's going to be challenged in your life if you take to following Jesus seriously, this notion of seeing is believing. It's not untrue. It's not wrong. It's just incomplete. Now, one of the things that comes out of Bible study, and those of you who have attended Bible study with me have heard this before, is that many times what we glean out of a Bible study when we're with a group of people is true. It's just not complete. I share this all the time because as I'm doing the Bible study with the people here at the church, I tell them that at this time, in this moment, in this place, in history, this is what I'm gleaning from this passage. And it's true. But if I revisit this passage again in a day, a week, a month, a year, then I'll glean something new that I didn't see before. And that something new doesn't say that what was before was wrong. It just is incomplete. And so seeing is believing is true. It's just incomplete, especially when it comes to our relationship with God, especially when it comes to how we understand the nature of God and how we walk every single day as a follower of Jesus. Seeing is believing. So as we pull this apart and as we start to deconstruct that notion in our lives, the first thing that we have to do is we have to come to terms with the understanding of what does it mean to see? What does it mean to see? That's our question. And so to understand this question, we've got to look much deeper than just the eyes. We've got to look much deeper than just the things that we actually physically can see in our lives. What does it mean to see? It means to know through experience. To see means to know through experience. And so seeing here is so much more than what meets the eye. It is a relationship. It is a connection. It is an experience to see. Again, listen to the words of Job as he is ending up this whole ordeal, this whole process of being introduced to a new perspective of God. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Now, the one thing that we know from reading Scripture is that it's impossible really for us to see God. For God is too great. God is too powerful. We have passages in Scripture where Moses wanted to see him, and God said, no, you can't look at me straight on, but I can walk by, and you can hide in the cleft of the rock. And as I go by, then you can look at the back of me as I'm going on. We have stories from the Old Testament about the Ark of the Covenant, which was at that time, because there was no temple, there was no home for God. That was really God's home, and they would carry the Ark of the Covenant around. But if anybody touched the Ark of the Covenant, they would drop dead. And so this notion of seeing God, physically seeing God with our eyes, is biblically an impossibility. So the seeing must mean more. So what does it mean to see God? As Job says, it means to know through experience. To know through experience. And that's this notion of seeing that we want to talk about. That notion of seeing that we want to put in our lives when we think about our relationship with God. How do I know God? Through experience. How can I see God? How can I see God? And the first thing that we understand as we take a look at this knowing through experience understanding of seeing is that seeing is a choice. Seeing is a choice. Now, you and I might not have a choice about what we see every single day. I mean, there's been many times in my life where I've seen something and I've said, oh, scrub the brain. I wish I didn't see that. But when we come to this notion of knowing through experience, we all have a choice. We all have a choice to make. We are coming upon Holy Week, we're coming upon Easter. And in that Easter story, over and over again, we're reminded of the ministry of Jesus. As God walked on the earth as man, as God walked the earth in the person of Jesus, as he healed, exorcised demons, brought people back to life from the dead, there were still people that didn't believe, even though they saw it. Why? Because they made a choice. They made a choice not to see it. They made a choice not to believe what they were seeing. For them, seeing wasn't believing. Because they saw it, they still didn't believe it. So seeing is a choice that you and I make. And if you're going to make a decision to be a follower of Jesus, then you need to make a decision about how you're going to see God. Remember, we define seeing by knowing through experience. How are you going to know God through the experience of your life? And that's a choice that we make. For some, the knowing of God, the seeing of God is the judge. Is the judge and the jury. Is the hellfire and damnation. Is that you better act right or you're going to hell. Others choose to see God as the grandmother on the front porch in the swing waiting to receive you. Now, both of those versions of God are true. They're just incomplete. They're incomplete. God is judge and jury. God is the final word. He is the Alpha and the Omega. And there are consequences that we as his children will pay if we do not follow him. God is the loving grandmother on the front porch swing, waiting to receive us in her arms, waiting to give us warm chocolate chip cookies, waiting to make us feel all better. Those both are true. They're just incomplete on their own. It's a choice how we see God. And this week, I invite you to take some time and ask yourself, how do I see God? How do you see God? What is God to you? Who is God to you? And again, understand that that description that you come up with, that explanation that you come up with, is not going to be wrong. It's just going to be incomplete because there's more to God than meets the eye. There's more to God than what you and I can understand in our little brains at any given moment. It's through the experience that we have with God that we begin to see God. And so once you start to define God, once you make the choice to see God, and once you can define that seeing, then you start to understand the experience that you have with God. Some people understand the experience they have with God, thus they know how they see God. Some people see God, thus defines their experience with God. But the first thing you got to do is you got to take some time to figure that out for yourself. Again, listen to the words of Job. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. And this is where it gets tricky. And at this time, when I share this with you, you've just got to wrestle with it. You can't shoot the messenger. I'm not making something up. I'm sharing with you some cold, hard truth that you've got to wrestle with. And that is that God requires you to believe before you can see. God requires you and me to believe before we can see. And that's the thing that's hard, because we are a type of person, remember at the beginning, seeing is believing, that we want to see everything and then we'll believe. You show me and then I'll sign up. You give me the truth and let me see it, then I'm all in. And God is operating in a different way. He's saying, no, I want you to make the choice to believe, and then you can see. Because remember, seeing is a choice. So I want you to make the decision to love me, and then you will see. I want you to make the decision to follow me, and then you will see. I want you to make the decision to be my child, and then you will see. And that's hard for us, because we kind of want to see the merchandise before we pay for it. We want to look under the hood before we buy the car. But God doesn't operate that way. And that's hard for us. And that's why seeing is a choice. Remember, as we're defining seeing, seeing is to know through experience. So for us to experience the nature of God, for us to experience the fullness of God, we must have an experience that's based on faith. We must have an experience that's based on believing. It can't be an experience that's based on just random chance or accident. We've got to make a choice to believe before we can see. Again, listen to the words of Job. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. To see, to be seen, is to exist, to be real. And that was the line from the movie that kind of led me to this series in Avatar. Because when they looked at each other and they say, I see you, basically what they're doing is they're saying, I acknowledge your existence. And when we get right down to it, each and every single one of us desires that acknowledgement of our existence. Hear me, see me, experience me. This is what we all seek. And it's the same way in our relationship with God. God is saying to us, I want you to see me. I don't want you to just know about me. I don't want you to just have my rookie card and know all my stats. I want you to know me. And I want you to see me because I see you. Because God sees us. God sees you just the way that you are. And here's the rub. He loves you just the way that you are. And so as we take a look at this notion of seeing throughout this Easter season, we come to this understanding that we have a choice to make. And that choice is to be seen and to see. For to be seen is to exist, to be real. And God wants to be real to you today. God doesn't want to be a shiny cathedral to you today. God doesn't want to simply be the words to a song today. God wants to be real to you today. He wants to be right down in your life with you today. He wants to be seen because he sees you. Again, listen to the words of Job, because Job experienced this in his life. My ears had heard of you. Job knew all about God. Job could quote all the scriptures. He knew the right prayers. He knew how to sacrifice the right animals at the right time. He knew what to do. But it was only through the turmoil, it was only through the experience of life that he got to the point where he said, but now my eyes have seen you. But now my eyes have seen you. To be seen is to exist, to be real. In this moment, chapter 42, verse 5, for the first time in Job's life, God becomes real. He becomes real, not just something that's a part of a religion, not just something that's part of a tradition or a custom, but he becomes real. He sees him. And all humans want to see God. There's not a human being out there that doesn't want to see God. But most humans will only see the people who claim to have a relationship with God. And that's the thing that's hard, is that the unfortunate reality is for you and I who are following Jesus, for you and I who are claiming and striving to live into that child of God identity, is that we're going to encounter people in our lives that are going to base their understanding of God, base their understanding of Jesus, base their understanding of the Bible, base their understanding of Christianity only on one thing, and that is you. How you live your life, how you react, how you treat others, how you spend your money, how you use your free time. And it's totally unfair. Totally unfair that that happens, because none of us are perfect. None of us can live up to that kind of scrutiny. And my hope and my prayer today is that you who are listening to this or are watching this, if you are one of those people that have not seen God for yourself, you're merely watching other people and seeing what they do and relating that to God, my prayer is that you make a choice to see God, that you make a choice to move past just hearing about God with your ears, but actually seeing him with your eyes. Again, to know through experience. And this is very hard for us because, let's face it, it's easier. It's simply easier if we just find somebody, maybe a preacher somewhere or maybe a family member somewhere, and we just say, well, that's God. That's Jesus. That's Christianity. That's the church. It's just easier because we don't have to work. This seeing stuff is work, and that's why Job is so difficult for us. We might think that Job as a book is difficult for us because we don't like the way that God treats him. We don't like the fact that God allows Satan to do things to him, to take his family and his wealth. But really, when we get down to it, when we read all the way through and we read verse 5 of chapter 42, we come to this understanding and the realization that what we really don't like about Job is the fact that it puts the responsibility right back on our plate. And it calls us, invites us, encourages us to see God with our eyes, to move past someone who merely knows about God to someone who knows God. Let's join together and pray. Lord, as we begin this process, as we begin this move towards Easter, as we begin this new series on seeing you, seeing ourselves, seeing each other, we ask that you open up our eyes. You open up our eyes, you open up our hearts, you open up our minds, you open up our ears, that you help us to experience you. Lord, I pray for the person who is out there today that doesn't have an experience with you. Maybe they have an experience with the church. Maybe they have an experience with someone who follows you, but they haven't had an experience with you. Lord, I pray that they would stick through this process and they would be open to an experience of you. They'd be open to see you. Lord, I pray for the person today who is going through a hard time. They're struggling. Maybe they're struggling because of health issues. Maybe they're struggling because of financial issues. Maybe they're struggling because of relationship issues. Lord, I pray that not only would there be healing, would not only be wholeness, not only will there be health in that situation, I also too pray, Lord, that they move past just hearing about you. And through this time, they see you. Lord, that's the prayer for all of us, that we would see you, that we would know you through the experience of our lives. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So as we come to a time of communion, we invite you to get whatever elements you're going to use for communion as we celebrate together virtually. Even though you're not physically in the sanctuary with us, we are together through the internet. So if you have to, go ahead and pause the video and go to the kitchen and get some bread or a cracker, get something to drink, and bring it back, or take us with you. That's a good thing about being virtual worship. You can take us with you wherever you are. You can take us into the kitchen, and we can celebrate communion together. Whenever you have your elements, then just come back. Come back and join us. As we celebrate communion together, we celebrate this mystery of life, the mystery of a life that we don't fully and totally understand. There's so many things in this world that we can get a grasp on, that we can understand. We have made so many achievements in science and technology, and it's amazing. The very fact that we're doing this right now over the internet, it's an amazing gift. But alongside that, there is still so much more that we don't know. There's so much unknown, so much that we don't understand, and some of that not understanding, some of those things just frustrate us. And so I invite you to come to the table with that frustration. I invite you to come to the table with all of that knowledge and all of that ignorance all at the same time. Many times we feel that we have to be a certain way in order to come to the table. We have to do it in a certain style and use certain words. But tonight, today, this morning, whenever you're doing this, we just invite you to come. To come just as you are, in the midst of coronavirus, in the midst of questions and concerns, in the midst of not understanding. We just invite you to come and to be present. To be present in this moment. To connect with each other virtually. To connect with those that are in your house right now. To just be. Just to be present. That was the invitation that Jesus gave his disciples in that upper room that night. He invited them to come and to be present. And it's amazing because we have to remember that one of the disciples that he invited to come to that upper room, whose feet he washed, who he served, was Judas. He was at the table that night. So we invite you to come and to celebrate with us. Regardless of where you are on the spectrum tonight, today, or this morning, wherever you happen to be, we invite you to come and to celebrate. That night in the upper room, Jesus took the bread and he raised it up to heaven and he blessed it. Now, Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless this bread. We ask that you bless whatever element people are using at this moment to celebrate communion. We ask that in this time and in this place, that it becomes the bread of life, that it becomes that which feeds our souls, that feeds our souls in times of questioning, in times of fear, in times of wondering. Lord, we come to this table just as we are, and we need your food. We need your touch. And so we ask that you would feed us today, that you would feed us through this table, that you would feed us through our faith. We ask that you bless this bread in the name of Jesus. And he said, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. Take and eat all of it, and do this in remembrance of me." And then after supper, Jesus took the cup and he raised it up to heaven and he blessed it. Lord, we ask that you would just open up our eyes, that you would open up our eyes so that we may see. See more than just the world around us, but to see your grace, to see your love, to see your forgiveness, to know you in a deeper way. Lord, use this cup to cleanse us. Use this cup to refresh us. In the name of Jesus. And he said, this is the new covenant spilled out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink all of it and do this in remembrance of me. As has become our custom, we close our worship with the backdrop of an empty sanctuary. For we know there will come a time when we will be able to fill this place up again. But until that time comes, we praise God that we have the ability to be here virtually with you. And so this week, we pray that you stay safe. We pray that there's health and wholeness in your home. We pray that this time of reset, this time of change, will open your eyes into a new kind of way that will introduce you to something new. We pray that this time brings you closer to God. So until we meet again, go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.